I'm gonna say so many names wrong in this video. I'm the Knight is a six-part miniseries written by Sam Sheridan and produced, among others, by Patty Jenkins, best known as the director of Wonder Woman and Monster. The series is inspired by the real life and autobiography of Fauna Hodel and follows a young Fauna in 1965 on her journey to learn the truth about her biological family. While I Am the Knight is based on a true story, I won't be concerned in this video with how it adapts that story to screen. Instead, I'll be approaching it the way that I might approach a work of fiction. Because I Am the Knight is about a lot of things. It's about race, gender, war, PTSD, police brutality, motherhood, just to name a few. But the theme that stood out the most to me was that of art and the way that it's entwined with misogyny. Art is a theme that runs through most of the series, but it comes to the forefront in episode 4, Matador. While nearly all of Matador is about art, the most striking scene in the episode, in my opinion, is actually at the end of the episode when journalist Jay Singletary stumbles across a room filled with art owned by George Hodel, Fauna's secretive and frightening grandfather. While looking at the paintings, Jay makes a connection between the dismembered, disfigured bodies and the murdered women that he's seen or taken photographs of, primarily that of the real-life Elizabeth Short, best known as the Black Dahlia. This scene is striking because it's played without dialogue, instead cutting back and forth between shots of Jay looking at the paintings, shots of the paintings, and shots of the photographs of the murdered women. And then it ends. Typically, at the end of an I Am the Knight episode, before the credits roll, we're shown photographs of the real-life people that were involved in the episode. But Matador precedes its credits with photographs of actual artwork by surrealist artists such as Man Ray, Max Ernst, and Salvador Dali. The final scene of the episode makes a tie between the artwork and the murders, but including these photographs along with the names of their artists, artwork displaying those same dismembered bodies, is making a very clear statement that the misogyny displayed in the fictional episode is not confined to it, but that the misogyny is inherent in all such surrealist art. Now, some may disagree with me. I remember reading the Wikipedia summaries for each episode. Don't worry why I read Wikipedia summaries. I mean, it's nothing. Summaries are useful in the way that subtitles are useful. But the thing with summaries is that they can only present the interpretation of the person who wrote them and not the actual content itself. The episode summary for Matador said at the end that, quote, "Jay realizes that the works depicting pieces of women's bodies are the inspiration for the murders he is investigating, and that the killings were not done out of hate." I don't know who wrote that summary, but they're wrong. The issue is, even if George Hodel was inspired by the artwork that he keeps in order to commit sort of tributes to them, it cannot be ignored that the artwork is all of mutilated women's bodies, and that all of George Hodel's victims in this story are women. That isn't like a purely artistic drive. That comes from an inability to recognize women as whole beings. That comes from misogyny. And the show's focus on the relationship between the artistic images and the literal physical reality, as well as the display of like Man Ray and Dolly's works at the end, implies that it's not about to shy away from this topic. Earlier in the episode, Fauna is invited by her step-grandmother Corinna to attend an event referred to as a happening. It's a sort of artistic gathering and show. When Fauna joins a select few to witness Corinna's happening, a sort of performance art piece in an isolated part of the building, Corinna is waiting in a red dress and laying on a sort of concrete platform seat. An assistant pours a bucket's worth of scissors around her and then uses a pair of scissors to make a single cut in Corinna's dress. The assistant then passes the scissors to a waiting member of the audience who follows suit. The performance becomes a series of people cutting Corinna's dress, often touching or moving her to do so, but without anyone involved saying a word. When the scissors are passed to Fauna, she approaches Corinna before dropping the scissors on the ground and stepping away. This is the one piece of art made by a woman that gets any focus in the series, and it's a piece about violation. Corinna is touched, her dress is destroyed, she never speaks to ask for it or give consent. The participating audience members never think to ask if they should cut her dress. They do it simply because it's what's being done. They just follow suit. Fauna is the only person who chooses not to cut Corinna's dress. After her performance, back in Corinna's dressing room, Corinna asks Fauna if she liked her happening, and Fauna responds no, explaining that, "I think you just wanted us to be responsible for you, joining in or even just watching, doing nothing. Either way, you would have been the one getting hurt." And while Fauna's comment is meant to be a criticism of Corinna's art piece, it points to the complicity that is inherent in Corinna's performance. Everyone in that room was participating. Their choices, whether to join or just watch, were choices that affected the piece. Even Fauna, in dropping the scissors and refusing to participate, was participating. It's impossible not to. It's telling that before Fauna gives her explanation, Corinna initially thinks badly of Fauna's dislike of the performance.
Avant-garde needs courage. Do you know what that word means? Avant-garde.
No, ma'am.
Think of it as a term for an advanced, profound conscience based on a deeper understanding of history. It takes hard work and study. We have another word for art that is easy to enjoy. Kitsch. Like a television show. So, was it just me getting my clothes snipped off?
Yes, ma'am.
There is nothing worse in this world than a literalist thinker. Willful stupidity. I hate talking after these things. Do you even know what that word means? Literalist.
Yes, ma'am.
The important part of the discussion here is that, literal or not, the cutting of Corinna's dress is tied in with Fauna's dislike of the art piece. Because even with its commentary and higher meaning, it's still a display of violating or hurting Corinna. So I'm bringing this scene up, obviously, as an example of the way that the series depicts art commenting on violation. But I'm also bringing it up as the series' one example of art by a woman. Because, of course, there were female surrealists. Claude Cahun and Frida Kahlo are a couple of examples. Both of them created artwork that depicted dismembered women's bodies. But Cahun's photographs and Kahlo's paintings were self-portraits. They had a subjectivity. Rather than displaying women as objects onto which male artists projected their violent and sexual desires. Scholar Rudolf Quenzi describes the use of women in male surrealist art. They are depicted as tools or mediums through which the dreams of men are recorded, or through which men can access the unconscious. He refers as well to the psychoanalysts Sigmund Freud and Jacques Lacan's misogyny, in that they believed that women were closer to the unconscious, because they haven't entirely entered the symbolic order, which is another way of saying they believed that women were primitive or less evolved. The surrealists lived in their own masculine world, with their eyes closed, the better to construct their male phantasms of the feminine. They did not see woman as a subject, but as a projection, an object of their own dreams of femininity. Faced with the female figure, the male surrealist fears castration, fears the dissolution of his ego. In order to overcome his fears, he fetishizes the female figure. He deforms, disfigures, manipulates her. Scholar Daniel Canafo describes another difference between male and female surrealist artists, namely that Frida Kahlo depicts the trials of her physical body, including miscarriage. This is significant because male surrealists, as Canafo puts it, were always pursuing the mistress and ignoring the mother. Motherhood is a topic completely avoided by male surrealists, so perhaps it's significant that motherhood is such a large topic in I Am the Night. Fauna is caught between Jimmy Lee, her adopted mother who raises her, and Tamara, the birth mother she doesn't know. And throughout the series, Fauna is trying to connect with and understand Tamara's stepmother, Corinna. In the final episode, brief attention is even given to George Hodel's mother, as well as the real-life Fauna's own motherhood. So I Am the Night is not only not avoiding motherhood as a topic, but is actually really rather concerned with subjectivity, which is a topic we'll, like, come back to a little bit later. But first, we're actually going to take a little look at other instances of surrealist art in I Am the Night. We have George Hodel's friend and protege over here making Vanya from the Umbrella Academy, which he is then implied to attempt to replicate on Fauna. So the artistic here is becoming irrevocably tied with the literal. And then the art in Hodel's gallery room, a clear representation of the literal mutilation of women, inspired by art, inspired by real and violent misogyny. The first photograph from the end of Matador is of Manray's Venus Restored, inspired by Venus de Milo of classic antiquity. Scholar Kristen Hoving describes the piece as tightly bound, this torso's form and the tradition it represents are contained, limited, and fetishized by the modern artist who can choose on what terms to restore the antique. In this case, the artist chose to restore her with not only her arms removed, but also her legs and head. The final act of restoration is that she is bound. It's not uncommon for women in surrealist art to be bound or contained. There's even an example of it in the final scene of Matador, where a woman's body, hollowed out, becomes something like a cage. Daniel Canafo describes the tendency, referring to different types of art pieces, but it's a sort of same kind of tendency, saying objects associated with the adored women are sometimes placed in vials and fitted into intricate wooden chests, fetishes that allow him to possess the glamour through which beautiful women exert power over men. This is reminiscent as well of the keyhole image in I Am the Night, which Jay connects with the dead body of Janice Brewster. Not unlike Dolly's depiction of Venus as a chest of drawers, these depictions from I Am the Night portray women as containers. But not containers to be opened. The nature of their mutilation or cage-like appearance calls instead for them to remain trapped. Those binding ropes, too, aren't unlike the violin strings from Mr. Sepp's piece. When showing her to us, the camera lingers less on her eyes. They seem incomplete, the left eye not quite slotted into place, yet illuminated in a way that gives the illusion of an iris and pupil. And the scene implies that it is complete. And eyes are important. Vanya here is shown to us in episode 3, Dark Flower, the same episode that introduces us to Tamar Hodel, Fauna's birth mother. Tamar appears in the opening scene as a young girl, awake past her bedtime. She stumbles across her father and his guests being entertained by masked, nude women. A surrealist scene in its own right, it's all about eyes and watching. It's a scene of Tamar watching George, of George watching Tamar watch him, of Tamar watching George watch her watch him, and of us watching exactly what the camera wants us to see. And what we're watching is misogyny. It's the misogyny of the women being sexual objects for George and his male guests to play with. It's the misogyny of knowing Fauna's birth date and therefore knowing that Tamar would give birth to her in only a few years' time. It's the misogyny of violence against a woman for no discernible reason. But it's also the misogyny of the series itself, because we are seeing exactly what the camera wants us to see. And so this is where the series fails in its exploration of surrealist art and falls into the same trap. The women in this scene become nameless, faceless objects with no subjectivity. They don't even speak. They only giggle or sigh. The violence against them is sexualized. Their nude bodies are displayed for the sexual desire of the viewer, and they become parts instead of a whole. While this is George Hodel's party and George Hodel's misogyny, his misogyny has clearly been depicted in other parts of the series with outstripping women of their subjectivity, which means that this scene is undoubtedly the misogyny of the series itself. If eyes represent a violating male gaze, we the viewers are thrust into that gaze long after Tamar has run from the scene. The camera, the director, the writer even, are committing this misogyny, and we, the viewer, are participating. For a series that is critical of misogyny, it's surprising in its willingness to commit it, or at least I wish it was surprising. Another such instance comes at the end of episode 5, Aloha, when Jimmy Lee, Fauna's adopted mother, is visited at home by George Hodel. There's a frightening tension in this scene, as both the viewer and Jimmy Lee are aware that she is in danger. And Jimmy Lee keeps a clear head about it. She's really smart. She fills a pan with oil, because she's, like, cooking steak. So she, like, waits till the oil gets really hot, and then when a neighbor knocks on the door and distracts George, she, like, throws the whole pan and the oil at him and makes her escape, only to trip on the door frame and then be overcome by George, which is absurd. And I know that's not a scholarly thing to say, I am so sorry, but it is absolutely absurd. Like, how does somebody, especially somebody who, like, kept very clear head, was very smart in this situation, trip on a door frame? Like, is that even possible? Can you trip on door frames?
Oh no, I tripped on a door frame.
By all accounts, it just doesn't even make any sense. A scene like that isn't necessary. In fact, if there are many different ways that you can make the plot go in the direction that you want to without a scene like that. And so, unfortunately, the only reason I can think of adding a scene like that is because the writer or the director or somebody wanted the perverse pleasure of watching a black woman get stabbed. And make no mistake, that is exactly what we see as the camera makes sure that we can see her back, that we can see the knife penetrate her, that we can see the blood on her nightgown. She lives, by the way. That's another part, actually, that she lives, because she's, like, was a real person, and she didn't die in 1965, so the show couldn't kill her off. The show's final blow appropriately comes in its final episode, Queen's Gambit Accepted. This episode puts the focus back on the art, and then immediately begins to show its hand and ruin its own argument. Fauna, having been drugged and returned to George Hodel's house, is with him when he's looking upon his latest artistic requisition, which is either a Rothko or is meant to at least appear like a Rothko. It's an abstract piece that's meant to convey something without, like, sort of literal discernible objects. Hodel's interpreting the painting as a window reveals that he's a literalist, seeing only what the painting looks like, literally a window, rather than its abstract meaning. This calls back to the opening scene of the episode during George Hodel's childhood in 1917, where a piano teacher is trying to explain to his mother,
"I'm very sorry, but I cannot teach him."
"Why ever not? His last instructor, Dr. Simmelman, said..."
"Madame, please, Simmelman. Your son is, he is talented. But he plays without emotion, the hardest thing to have. It cannot be taught. At least I cannot teach him. He's a mimic, a precise machine. Put him into medicine or science."
So instead of Hodel being a misogynist, participating in and acting as commentary on the misogyny of surrealist art, he's rewritten here as a mimic and a literalist, someone who doesn't understand the art at all. This is brought home at the end of the episode. George Hodel decides to paint Fauna, which we take to mean both a literal portrait of her and also to murder her. Fauna bides her time, going along with his requests until the right moment to strike. She frees herself and holds him at gunpoint, saying,
"No, not yours. I know who I am. I'm Jimmy Lee's daughter. I will never be yours. We all know what you are, George. You're a cliche, just like a pimp raping his own daughter. Boring, George. Pretending simple urges are high art. You're boring."
And in one fell swoop, it's like the show is taking back everything it had to say about art and Matador, and imply instead that the only reason George Hodel infuses his work with violence and misogyny is because he doesn't understand art. That the art we saw in Matador portraying visceral mutilation, invoking a real kind of pain, doesn't actually do any of that. That it's perfectly fine to disfigure and dismember women so long as it's for the art. And so, In the end, the series pulls back and decides to redeem surrealism. So the question remains, why bring surrealism into this? Why criticize it only to retroactively redeem it? I believe it's because I Am the Night needed surrealism, or at least a vehicle like it, in order to make the argument it wanted to make. In her article on surrealism's recreations of Venus, Hoving, after analyzing mutilated female body after mutilated female body, concludes that while some might see misogyny in it, the recreations of Venus are more complicated, but that, quote, to be sure, this is an upsetting rendition of disjointed human body. I disagree, primarily because it's not just disjointed human body, it's always disjointed woman's body, and that can't just be ignored. But as much as I disagree with her willingness to dismiss the art's misogyny, I do agree with another statement she made in her conclusion. When Venus can be beheaded, when a neoclassical nude can become a violin, when real bodies can turn into marble or melt into liquidity, the rules that govern the way things are give way to a new universe of possibilities. For surrealists, it was crucial that beauty not be a fixed concept, as it had been in the past, but that its center of gravity be constantly shifting, that beauty be open to metamorphosis. It is for precisely this reason that I Am the Night needed surrealism. Remember when I said to keep in mind how the show was concerned with subjectivity? This is why. The series doesn't have any particular interest in beauty, but it is very concerned with identity, and it's on this topic that it has something very specific it wants to say. And it tries to say this through Fauna's subjectivity. It needed surrealism to dissolve boundaries, because the truth is Fauna will never be able to define herself in terms that are acceptable to society. Fauna was raised as a mixed-race girl, someone who already couldn't find belonging in one world or the other, only to learn that she isn't mixed-race after all. But learning that her birth parents are both white can't erase who she is or the experiences that shaped her. Discovering her father's darkness and the way in which it might be mirrored in her own doesn't define her. I Am the Night argues that identity is a thing that can't and shouldn't be fixed or contained, that it too must be open to metamorphosis. And to make this argument, I Am the Night had to redeem the very surrealist art it had shown discomfort with 2 episodes prior. I'd like to state for the record, I'm actually a big fan of surrealist art. Please don't at me